My name is Padma Priya. I'm a director from Grant Thornton, leading the Smart Cities Initiative and the urban sector for the firm. As we are all aware, today's session is more in creating a smart ecosystem through the Smart City program that has already been launched by the Government of India. And we do have eminent professionals from the IT industry who are trying their bit to make this program a big success. So I will just hand over the mic to each of you to just give a line of introduction, and we can then start the discussion. So,
sir. My name is Vikram Kumar. I am from Cisco Systems. I lead the business development practice for Cisco, focused on the smart cities, BharatNet, and various other initiatives. Thank you.
Venu Nair, President and CEO of TASIC. We are a Tata Advanced Systems company, specifically looking into security, both security of physical spaces through the deployment of technology. So a lot of the surveillance, safe city things come under that purview. We also have a cybersecurity interest where we look at security of technology systems, as everyone kind of understands. And our vision is to look at how in the future we provide integrated solutions which span across both of these domains, the physical kinetic domain as well as the cyber domain.
Hey, good afternoon. Thank you. So my name is Prasoon Talukdar. I manage the digital transformation practice and the public sector strategy for Hewlett Packard Enterprise. Primarily, what we do is that try to position our or the understand the customer's need with respect to the digital transformation in government, in state or central government, and engage with the various stakeholders and the consultants, and try to bring the technologies which is there for make the transformation possible for the Indian environment. Thank you.
Very good afternoon. I'm Sanjeev Gupta, General Manager with Microsoft. I look after the India business, especially the education, healthcare, government, defense, multiple sectors. But my interest lies is the urban here, and that's what Padma and I am here. And would love to have much engaged discussion today. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Ravinder Reddy. I'm a partner with Grant Thornton. I lead the government practice for Grant Thornton. As part of government practice, smart cities is also an important portfolio that I handle. Padma is a director in my practice, and we are the PMC in about 7 smart cities as of now. Thank you.
As Ravi was mentioning that we are already doing the project management consulting for several smart cities in India. And we are currently at a stage where the concepts of what a smart city should be has already been defined. And now we are more or less at a stage of converting that concept into concrete projects and then taking them over to an implementation phase. So at this critical juncture, we have a lot of questions as consultants also. And considering the fact that the physical infrastructure and the technology infrastructure, there has to be a good marriage between both of them in order to make this entire initiative a success, right? All of us agree to that. But the core elements of what should be an IT infrastructure in a smart ecosystem, what constitutes the smart ecosystem, is something I would like to understand from the panelists out here. Because what we have initially seen at the initial stages of this initiative has always been smart city itself as a definition is different to different people, while we all acknowledge that. Is that the same even in the minds of the technology providers? So that's the first thing which we would like to roll out. The second thing we also want to look at is that how citizen-centric are all of these technology the platforms that are being created? How much of citizens are able to actually get their actual benefit of having brought into this system? The third one, which we also want to cover in today's thing, is challenges are there, many challenges, but to us, we find that data availability is the biggest challenge today for them also to do anything with it, right? So how are these people going to look at how do we overcome such challenges? And of course, there are many other challenges we would like to cover, but I think this forum is limited just to about an hour. And since we have this kind of panelists here, I would like to just, you know, seek their views on these three aspects. Maybe we'll just take one at a time and then discuss and debate, and then maybe we can look at the second one. So let us start with, what exactly is the smart ecosystem mean to each of you? To you, Prasun.
So if you look at the smart ecosystem or smart cities, what is the end point what we want to reach? Most of you and all of us have heard about autonomous cars, right? Every one of us is looking at when these autonomous cars gets rolled out in India, and then we also see that they have an extraordinary impact on various industries, not just a transportation industry, the healthcare, the insurance, and then the way people invest onto the cars, every industry will get affected. Similar lines at Cisco, and our vision was also looking at how do we build into an autonomous cities. Fine, when we can do an autonomous car with a lot of data, sensors, and all informed, getting and then analyzing that at the back end and ensuring that things move, why can't we do that for a city where the city reacts on its own to any incident that is happening, or to an event that is happening, something like this in a city? We know how the traffic will change, pattern will change when we have 2,000 delegates that are coming in. How does the city react itself? And how do you address? It can be at the same time, the municipal corporation or the authority here knows that there is so much of wastage that can be there, so much of food that will come out. Then how do they take it off? So they need more number of vehicles to come and pick it up. And the traffic system. Similar way, an autonomous system to be developed, lot of ecosystem, it's not just one single entity or a small IT that can come and conclude that we can build such a city, but there are a lot of elements and ecosystems that has to come together to resolve this. See, we tried building, and honestly, lot of cities are under development, and then we did multiple pilots across India, and then I was actually involved in implementing a full-blown solution where we have taken more than 15 smart city use cases and deployed them in a city. So these, the challenges are immense, as I saw. We took what people thought and conceived was a 3-month idea, actually landed up into a year-long stretch as you start executing. Most of the people today in country have deployed IT solutions in a campus or within a buildings. But when we go to the field and deploy such large-scale IT solutions, the challenges are going to be immense and different. I'll stop here and other colleagues.
So if you start with the definition, right, so which kind of frames the conversation, you know, at its highest level, you look at a smart city as one which finds an efficient way of prioritizing its limited resources to deliver public services, you know, and solve urban challenges, right? So that's your 100,000-foot level definition. Now, if you take a technology lens to it, then you say that it's essentially about data and technology, and a smart city would make data and technology access available to various stakeholders. Stakeholders can be public services providers, parts of government. It could be interested private parties which see opportunity for both profit and for service there. And if you create this ecosystem, then you know you essentially have a smart city. So the question is, how do you create this data and technology infrastructure in a city which allows efficient and effective public services delivery? And so that would be my, you know, kind of take on it. Now, if you look at the question of what kind of infrastructure would be needed, I would think that it's, you know, it's a very uncertain, or it's a difficult question from the standpoint that if you look at sensors which generate the data, this is an area that's evolving at, you know, breakneck speed. You know, 2 years from now, we have sensors that we can't even conceive of today. And therefore, how do you come up with a plan which is not going to get executed in 3 months or 6 months, like he said? It'll be a multi-year project when you don't even know what the constituents will be. So I like to use the analogy of, you know, the IT industry and the whole concept of an enterprise architecture which existed 10, 15 years ago, when companies were looking at substantial technology upgrade. They came up with this idea that you have some overarching architecture and principles, and a lot of it was to do with, you know, having open systems, open interfaces, the ability to plug in things in the future. So I think it's something similar that we need here, which will enable you to You know, you might have a transportation system, you might have a set of sensors which allows you to kind of run the system, but tomorrow you might be implementing something which is for garbage collection, and maybe that provides some data which can still be used, you know, by the transportation system in order to make it more efficient. So to allow these cross linkages, you really have to have truly open architecture systems, and that therefore goes to say that much as technology vendors and companies with, you know, specific private interest would like to push in, you know, closed ecosystems, saying one-stop shop, we can provide you every solution under the sun. I don't think that will be in the city's benefit to go for that. It is to much more to have a pick and choose play, though it's a much more complex problem than to handle the entire technology question to one player and have them take care of it. So I don't know if that's an answer, but you know, these are some thoughts around it.
I think it's a very relevant point highlighted by Venu and Vikram. I'll just give you a slightly different perspective. You know, what are the challenge which we are actually seeing in this smart city implementation? Because you know what we have seen last one and a half years, there are multiple projects that are happening in India, and what Ravi also said that you know what are the challenges. You know, we are also facing as a consultant, and being a technology vendor, we are also seeing a lot of challenges there. If we broadly see, there are four challenges. One is, you know, technological challenge, which is primarily we'll find most of the Indian cities are old, you know. So retrofitting of any smartness, any infrastructure or any other parameter which is coming up is not easy for our cities. Very few cities are, you know, coming from the scratch, maybe for DMIC, you know, front-ended projects. But most of them are old cities, right? Second point is that, you know, financial challenges, economic challenge, right? So how it will be viable, because most of the ULBs are kind of loss-making. Hardly there are ULBs which are having profits. So how do they sustain these projects? It's not a project of 1 year. It's a project of 7 years, 8 years down the line. And third point definitely is political challenge is there. But good part is that I think 100 smart city mission announced, so there's a political willingness and things are on track. Fourth factor, what is very important, I think some of us are discussing outside, is that social part of it. Is citizens are involved, engaged, okay? Are they being taken care? Are they in the central to these whole initiatives or not, right? So if you look at these four things, I think there are a whole lot of gaps. You know, only technology cannot bridge the gaps, but yes, technology also can bridge a lot of gaps. Now, looking at the India perspective, there are three things. We have probably the highest mobile penetration. 1 billion mobile, 500 million, you know, internet population. So there's a good amount of platform which actually can, you know, get the things on track if the services or the applications or the technology which is coming up or being implemented, you know, implemented through the mobile technologies or through internet, right? Because mobile has changed the, you know, whole things in India in the last 10 years. And second part is that, you know, which definitely we are talking about sensors, is all about IoT, right? So what mobile has done for India in the last 10 years along with the internet, I think we are very hopeful that IoT is going to play much bigger role, because it's not a connecting people, it is connecting people and connecting assets, whether it's the buildings, your waste management, your power, water, utility, SCADA systems, you talk about anything, right? Now you can connect everything, and then top of that, you definitely can create lot more new services, which, you know, Venu and Vikram was talking about, you know, intelligent transport system or adaptive transportation, right? Where, you know, a citizen want to go from, you know, one place of Delhi to another place. And we actually don't know how to reach in that other place within a particular time. But if I have this, you know, IoT technology along with internet and mobile available with an application, and then I exactly know, using the multimodal transportation system, I can reach a particular place, a particular predictable time, right? So point is that a smart city has got multiple dimensions, okay? Whether it is a transportation, water, utility, internet, broadband, telecom, everything. But, you know, the unique point which is coming up from an India purpose perspective is that we have to look at how things can be implemented much better way, more realistic way, on a platform which India has already created. I think mobile, internet, IoT is going to play a huge role. And, you know, within this room, I think there are many technology vendors, there are system integrators representing here. Last point I will highlight is that what we have also seen is that traditionally the IT companies in India, they are very good in, you know, implementing projects which is within the data center, application, e-governance. The moment it comes to the field, I think there is a still a gap, you know, how to integrate a data center technologies or application within the data center and what is in the field, okay? You know, there are construction companies, there are road building companies, they know it better, but they don't know IT. But, you know, IT companies like us, we know, internal to the data center stuff, but we don't know the field. Now, how to breathe, you know, both the things come together, and actually, that is going to be the key success factor for all the smart city projects going over. Thank you.
Thanks, great point, but I would turn around the discussion at a different level. Think about of almost every decade we are talking about of resources unutilized, resources not being efficiently utilized. Think about that line. And then the idea is, how can I make much more efficient resources or efficient way of using the resources? The journey of smartness started from there. Today, when we talk about of smartness and we talk about smart city, we're saying that A, because of the affordability of that technology which has been able to produce much more efficiently, can we use that now? Second point is the technologies are accessible to us. They are available in some part of the world, now it's available on the doorsteps. Can we use those technologies? We can. We have money, we have intent, we have willingness, and we have a pressure from the economy to use it more. Point taken. But is the technology, is the driver of a smart city ecosystem? I doubt. I clearly doubt. I say technology is an enabler, cannot be a prime driver. So friends, I think we have to think about of an ecosystem which is a very different lens altogether. Now when you say the ecosystem, then who is that part? What is that city is looking for? As you all know, every city is unique, perfectly fine. What city is looking at it? Please come and stay here with me in my community. It's a livable society. Please come here, invest money. It's an economy of the city which will grow. Please come here, academic institutions, because the students are here and they need some more growth and journey. That will create more revenue. That will create more attraction and much more living society, the law and order. Now that's the ROI of whatever we do. Whatever we do in the smart city, that's the ROI. That's the investment of a return of investment. Are we seeing that? And if you're seeing that part, then every city is very, very different. So the stakeholder will start from, say, you and I. The ecosystem will start from all of us together. And you make a point of citizens. Everybody has to be part of the ecosystem and design that USP of that particular city. A city in a hill region, a city in a plains, a city in a tourism, a city in an industrial belt is very, very different. Pick up that city as a USP and then figure it out of a technology as an enabler for the ROI that we are thinking of. I have never seen a conversation as on today, and I'm provoking this statement. I have never seen a statement by anybody saying, I want in my city 10,000 more great innovators coming and joining. Why? Because that's what the USP of that city might be, but they're not attracting that power. Bring that in now. And then you will find, if you pick up a challenge, let's say today, if I go and talk about of Varanasi, there might be issue of, you know, cleanliness maybe, there is issue of maybe of power, but that's an urgent one. Think about of this city who's gonna attract a millions of tourists in next decade. How do I make those tourists to come in that particular city and B, feel that this is where I would love to come again and again? That's the way the ROI will calculate it. So if the project cost is not affordable, it will be affordable if I see the ROI of that level in nature. And then the funding mechanism needs to be completely changed. Because if my funding when I go for, I can't go for funding mechanism by a center or a state contribution, that it has to be an equal participation with the industry collaboration as well, and the civil society collaboration as well to find out that funding mechanism, because a city is not for one SPV CEO. A city project is not for an individual of a vendor like us. A city project is for a city, so everybody will have to then put in their muscle power and think about it. That's the vision if you want to create that. And that's what I see, an ecosystem.
I think, Sanjeev, I totally second with your thoughts. and Prasoon, I second with your thoughts as well. So my, two or three takes on this subject is, a couple of years ago, when I was part of a team that drafted the first concept note on what a smart city means for India. That is, when we talk about Indian context, what does actually a smart city mean? So we drafted the document and that got released along with the program when this whole program was launched. And that's been 2 years since then. And now when I'm actually into this whole concept of smart cities, conceive those ideas that I wrote it on paper a couple of years ago, I realized that in India also there are different versions of smart cities. That means a template which is suitable for city A is completely not suitable for city B, and so on and so forth. So every city will have its own template of a smart city. So that's the first thing, right? And as I now see various cities, attempting different initiatives, I notice that the adaptability of smartness for various cities also varies, which means to say is while I talk about smart systems, it's not only the smart systems, it is the smart people also. That means if people are more adaptive, the city actually starts becoming smarter from day zero. But if people are not adaptive, I would implement the best systems, but still the city will nowhere close to being smart. So these are the various versions of smartness that I see emerging every day while doing this exercise. So that's my first take. And my second take is, as I said, a city will be as smart as its people are, and there's no denial to this fact. That means the willingness, willingness to participate in the whole exercise by the citizen communities, the whole program keeping citizen at the center of the program while designing every aspect of the program, citizen forums being active part of every aspect of smart city program. These are some critical parts which cannot be done away with for any exercise that we do under this program. So as long as we adhere to these basic parameters, I think some good initiatives will get launched and they will reach their achieved aim. So these are the two points that I had in mind to start the discussion, and we can carry on. Yeah, thanks. Yeah,
thanks all of you. So just to pick up from where Sanjeev had talked about, probably he was mentioning more on the supply side. The forces are more from the supply side, and probably we need to start looking at the demand side. This entire program itself started only with the demand side, actually, to say, because the vision of each city was developed very well in consultation with the citizens only. And then they picked up all the important points or the needs of the citizens and then framed it into a vision and converted that vision into certain projects which the things are. Obviously, there are two different, very starkly different types of projects. One is the need-based projects. So we still have the water supply, the solid waste management kind of projects on one side, and the hi-fi projects, the so-called hi-fi projects with very high level of IT interventions coming up from one side. So today we are left with a situation where we know that these are important, but at the same time, are citizens continuing to want this, So somewhere there is a superimposing role of a very fancy stuff, be it in a water supply system, be it in a thing, but the scheme was not designed to do so. The scheme started off, unlike any other smart city thinking in the outside world, India was very different. They said, we need to clear the grassroots. I mean, we need to get to the grassroots levels, have a proper water supply and distribution system, and then try and see whether you want a SCADA, you want a smart meter, etc. So today we have ground level issues at that itself. So how, what is your take on that? I mean, are we addressing the ground level issues correctly? Therefore, when are we going to achieve that? And therefore, when are we going to look at technology superimposing that? That's one option. The second option is might as well to do it together, like what many other cities are also doing. When we are laying a pipeline, might as well look at a fresh one and bring in the best technology and make, give good water to people. So that's something which I would like to throw open. I mean, your thoughts on that, not only in water supply, but in the general infrastructure. So anybody...
Yeah.
Okay. So, if I look at, because I've been in two large cities
looking at some of these solutions, at very focused, sitting and working on them. What we found is most of the cities in India actually went ahead and deployed multiple solutions in silos. There are solutions that are available in a city which actually tells them to the chief of the city what is the property tax collection, what is the water supply, and then what about the waste collection today, how was the local lighting done. But each of them has an independent system, each of them has its own dashboard, and in the morning there is somebody who takes a printouts of all those and puts it and leaves it on his table and walks off. Then he needs to really look at whether all areas have got. There is no clear dashboard, and none of them were actually having an option to integrate and bring in a clear view of that. So if you look at, yes, the most important aspects a city commissioner or a city mayor will look at is how the basic needs are taken care of. If not, he knows that he will not be back again in power, because it's a democracy and people choose your representatives. So the fundamental aspect, if you look at those things being deployed, but how do you address them if there is a gap that in particular area there is no water supply that has come in today, but how does a commissioner know, how does an officer on top of it know? There is no information unless somebody complains. From that stage to the next stage is what, when we integrate most of these resources, that is where I say there should be an over and above technology platform that should come in, and on top of it, it should be able to read from multiple sources of this data, correlate them and analyze them and give a proper view. So we looked at two or three large cities, as I told you. If you look at property tax collections and other issues, there was always a deficit in the collection of taxes. And when we actually look back, deep back into it, they are all actually the rich class areas of that city. Why do they miss out? Because if you put a gun on their head, they can just move in and pay immediately that amount. They don't have a problem. They can immediately pay online. When somebody goes and asks that, hey, you have not paid, you have to pay today, they will pay it up. But whereas if you go to the middle class, lower middle class areas, they actually plan their budget, and there the collection is actually much better in terms of percentage if you look back at 2-3 years of data on how did we collect before the due date or after the due date, how many paid with penalties. So like this, there is a, but if you ask me, in those areas, the focus of the local civic authorities is always very less. The focus is always on the other side of this one. So we need to really change, and I think some of these interventions at a higher level will enable that to happen, and also will enable citizens to complain, because they have, everybody has a visibility to the data of what is happening around in their city.
Okay, I think, you know, it's a very interesting question. I mean, there cannot be a single answer or the straightforward answer to this question, but as all of us has agreed that, you know, every city has its own DNA, and, you know, every city has its own priorities, and things are, you know, is not the same, right? So that is one point, one part of it. Second part is that I think, you know, what is important is that willingness to, you know, do the things on a right way, okay? Whether it's the political or from the authority or at the citizen point of view as well, right? Now, whether we'll follow the route of, you know, doing everything, you know, revamped, like infrastructure, like you said that, you know, whether we can make a single network where the water, electricity, everything is going in the same pipe or same duct, or it would be kind of, you know, improvement step by step, or then the technology intervention coming from the ICT point of view. I think these two are kind of extreme, but considering our city environment, which is more of old cities mostly, it has to go in parallel. You know, there has to be retrofitting, there has to be, you know, using technology, you know, minimum or the optimum way of finally delivering the quality service. So objective should be is that how we can deliver those selected services, which is the priority area, not everything. And it has to go with respect to infrastructure progress development as well as with using technology. Give one small example, you know, most of us are, you know, based out of Delhi. So, you know, Delhi NCR, we have seen recently the huge pollution problem suddenly, okay? Now, you know, all these things happen, suddenly there is a, you know, lot of action from just, you know, judiciary, from the political level to correct a lot of things. But if you look at, can you solve it in a day? It is not possible. Can you solve it with a technology? Probably alone it is not possible. So it's a combination of, again, the technology, infrastructure, and the willingness from the political, judiciary, and the authority, right? So I think, you know, these things are exactly similar for each and every city in different way. Like, you know, Varanasi, Sanjeev has talked about, probably that city requires a lot of, you know, cleanliness and stuff like that. And probably you go to, you know, some cities in Northeast, probably, you know, they are the one of the cleanest, you know, cities or the towns of the on the earth. So they need something different because there is no infrastructure at all. There is no basic water supply, clean water, electricity, 24/7. So, you know, I think, you know, point coming is that there is no extreme route. I think it has to be mixed, and depending on the city, DNA, city infrastructure, the combination has to be required.
To add with Padma, you talked about of two options, option one and option two. I think the answer lies somewhere in merits at option one and somewhere in option two in some merits. Let's take an example. When all the telecom operators can start sharing the towers to make it optimal use of the network, when everybody you know, start using a state and a national highway on a similar pattern across the country, that means what you're trying to drive is a collaboration, a cooperation, where you said the option one, wherein all the resources, infrastructure, can be leveraged in a holistic way, rather than on an individual for water and for energy for something else. Once pipe is there, let's build up a common pipe for everything. Example, how we do that, and especially when I take an IT perspective. In IT project, normally, correct me if I'm wrong, it's not our data which is published so easily, but it's roughly around 40 to 50% of the cost is actually a infrastructure cost. And how we can have this 40 to 50% of infrastructure cost can be reduced for various other initiatives that the SPVs can start looking at it. Can we reduce this? And the answer is, let's collaborate to make it a cloud-based technologies. Let's use that as an efficient way of picking up the right resources at the right time at the right place. And I think that's way of looking at the things when you design the optimal infrastructure side of the story. Give an example, in Jaipur, a complete street of 10 kilometers was a smart lighting system. How it happened? It just happened in a 3 months period of time, everything was done. If it has been a big IT project to make this happen, I can assure you it would have been completed 2 years. Things could have been done in much faster, much better way, lesser cost, citizens are happy, and the feedback is positive, and they're saying, please do it, replicate in all the other colonies in the Jaipur. We need to give this space within ourselves when we start looking at the infrastructure and the solution side. Just want to add that point.
So I think you've thrown open this to a larger discussion, especially when institutionally, how well are we structured? You know, because the third tier of government, being the local government, has very clear obligatory and discretionary functions for each municipality, right? The 16 set of functions or 12 set of functions, depending on whichever state it belongs to. And obviously, there is no chance for any of the two ULBs to come together to do that. The classic example is the regional landfill, which we tried, and it was a big failure. We said there are no landfills available, there is no land available to dump. So what we need to do is, even within the state, I'm saying, even within the state, let four or five ULBs come together, let the biggest, let the contract be handled by the biggest municipality, let the smaller municipality or the town panchayat start using a regional landfill system. It just didn't work, mainly because the escrow systems cannot be put together, right? Some of them had money, some of them did not have money. Even the richer corporations who were part of this, who were to own it, you know, put up their hands to say, why should I pay for your municipality? So we have inherent lack in the institutional system as such. So any thoughts on that? I mean, from a technology perspective, how do you think are, one is obviously we don't want to get into revising the laws and regulatory, that's a big aspect, right? Like we don't want to touch that. Anything else we can do where these SPVs together, without having to do anything on their constitutional status, can really look at, you know, some options. So if there are some concrete decisions which can come out of this, even however simple it is, then probably we can make a representation to the ministry.
Yeah, so let me try and, you know, as far as, you know, institutional mechanisms are concerned, I think there's been a mad rush to create SPVs, firstly, without actually giving thought to you know, the nature of the SPV or the mandate of the SPV or the, you know, for example, distribution of powers, segregation of duties, nothing has been. So, you know, these are the, and I'm not naming any particular city or naming any particular SPV here, but that's, you know, that's the feeling that I get when I discuss, when I meet and discuss a lot of things with these CEOs. In most cases, the CEOs, the municipal commissioners themselves are the CEO of the SPV also. So, you know, in a way, you know, what I'm trying to say is, while they have created the SPVs to enable spending, but are those SPVs independent enough to spend or, you know, initiate programs the way they choose to? Frankly speaking, I don't think so. They're, as of now, empowered that way. So, in a way, SPVs are trying to, you know, trying to do the same things that they were doing in traditional municipalities, probably doing it in a faster pace, but doing the same thing. So that's the lacuna with the institutional mechanism as of now, is what I feel. I sincerely feel that, especially in some, you know, critical cities and some important cities, they should identify SPVs and dealing the SPV from the traditional corporations, make SPVs independent, have, you know, definite segregation of duties, segregation of powers, and enable the SPV to undertake maybe two or three assignments at a time, rather than taking the whole lot together. I think if we take these minimal steps in the short term, some results can be achieved in the short term, is what I feel. But as of now, the way SPVs are structured, every SPV is trying to do everything. And more or less, they are amalgamated and integrated with the local corporation. So in that way, will something be achieved? We'll have to just wait and watch.
You see, if one municipal corporation which is rich in revenue is saying, oh, I should fund that, I think let's take the you know, logic that you built up earlier. Urban local body is trying to drive one, let's say, a solution. And if everybody in the ULB is able to pick up very small concept of interoperability, right, and plug in with the interoperability, very basic level, from the data to the application to the, you know, all layers of the, what you understand from technology side, the plug and play for the other ULVs will be much easier and faster, number one. Number two, if it is purely as a service rather than as an installation, then you can at least ask the other ULVs to pay as you use, right? So if you're using this much, just pay this much. Don't be part of a 40% equity share of a project, not required. So the second part that they can go for is this plug and play, pay per use. Plug and play is the interoperability one. And the third one is very critical one, which says that if a couple of ULBs together can come together and design a solution, not for themselves. Let's say, for example, I recently take an example in Madhya Pradesh, right? So recently we've seen, you know, Bhopal and Indore and everybody's cities club together and designed a one way that you want to go forward on smart cities. Fantastic approach. And that too also on the cloud. I think they are trying to shape the way the things should happen in the journey together. What we need to do is bring these, you know, gems, couple, bring these gems, you know, outside and say, prove them and say, look, this is what it is. These are some of the ULBs which are doing a great job. There's no, the learning of that ULBs to the other states in UP or in Karnataka or in other parts will be much, much faster. And that's the way that we can scale this up.
Hi, just to introduce myself, Prashant Gupta. I'm a partner with Grant Thornton. And hearing all of you, I think it's a very, very important point which you're raising. One is bringing the cohesive learning together. Also, if you see smart city as a concept, where it has been in the developed nation, it has been there. So we did some work around, like in Europe, in my earlier roles. And you see how Barcelona and other city have been successful. In different aspects, like they have tourism or you can say high mobility, some of the concepts which they have taken, and how those projects were rolled out in a period of 3 to 5 years. So there are already like proven ecosystem which have built successful models which are running. I'm not saying 100% it will be lift and shift. We can definitely do a knowledge transfer from there. Like say Telefonica is driving with the Barcelona municipality. What we are doing time to time, we are feeling here, we are again trying to reinvent the wheel with overwhelming that nothing will apply what has applied to the developed nation. That's not the case. We're not talking about greenfield here, and similar concepts were outside India. So there is a lot, even if we leverage 50 to 60% the models which are running, because the players again are same. You're talking again Cisco, you're talking again Verizon, you're again talking Airtel, you're again talking Telefonica. These are the same players, IBM, which have implemented. So why can't we replicate whatever is good learning, optimize the cost and reduce the time of going live? Otherwise, what will happen by the time we will do this, there will be some new concept which is already available. So just wanted to share. Thanks.
Yeah, go ahead. You know, I just one small point, you know, just to take a cue from what Sanjeev was saying is, yeah, so, you know, while they are champion cities outside India from which, you know, learnings can be taken, either in full or in parts and implemented, you know, in various parts. But I also think that champion cities will have to be created within the country also, because that's very important. Frankly speaking, as of now, there's no champion city as far as smart cities in India is concerned, on any concept. Even on command and control center, there's no champion city. Even on solid waste management, there's no champion city, right? So it's important for us to, at least on these three important points, to have champion cities who have done that, been there. And probably they should be the one which should be, you know, imitated and replicated at other places, in either in toto or in parts, whichever, you know, to whichever extent the things can be implemented in bigger or smaller cities. So I think that's another important point I wanted to.
I totally agree with the point that most of these cities should start looking at sharing the best practices and sharing the entire infrastructure together. The biggest problem is, earlier we used to actually fight with the government that why every state should build its own data centers. Now it has come down to every town, every urban municipality wants to build a data center. That's actually not really a scalable or a secure model. Honestly, first of all, okay, you can have some systems in place, but how do you ensure security of those systems, security of those applications running? Or if we have multiple tiers of administrative control, okay, city has got a dashboard and you have a data. Now at the state level, if the state government wants to see at multiple level and cities, what is the happening to their citizens in the entire state as such? No, because each one of them is operating in silos. Again, there is no way we can pull back together and cross-analyze and leverage that data. Same way, I think MOUD has done some great action in setting up the selection process. They have made it different. If not, as we have seen in multiple government projects, you just transfer the money to the state, it just doesn't get used. Now they made them participate, get selected and used, so there is some action. And at times we strongly, personal opinion I strongly feel is, in that SPV, other than the PMC, rest are all the same people who are currently managing the city. That cannot be the way. If you want differential thoughts to come and then the way you want to do different, then you need to have a different set of people also managing there. It's not mandated the collector is the chairman and the commissioner is the CEO. I think we need to change that concept also. Then I think really we can have different ideas, getting in best practices and implementing them.
Hi, my name is Asif. I'm from PwC India. And basically, I cannot see. I lost my eyesight when I was 16. And I work with the help of technology on my laptop and cell phone. And one of the aspects that I look into smart cities is incorporating digital inclusion. And since you're all thought leaders in your own domain, and PwC India has a number of projects in smart cities, but what the challenge right now is, even the RFP says you have to develop one of the main pillar of the smart city is that it has to be accessible both digitally and physical infrastructure wise. But the challenge is now system integrators, they already have a solutions which they have already rolling it out in some state and they just want to replicate. And as you are all, you just also mentioned that retrofitting a technology in the old city is difficult, the same way it's retrofitting digital accessibility into existing applications or smart city applications is difficult and very costly affairs. So according to you, how can we actually drive this no priority or low priority agenda? Because this is internationally there are standards internationally, it's driven by the United Nations that we have to make smart cities which is accessible to everyone. And unfortunately, the intentions are clearly spelled out. It's a good, but implementations, unfortunately, is very, very lacking. So how do we actually overcome this challenge? And this is one I'm just experiencing from my ground reality. And that is why I'm here, perhaps seeking your input and probably to tackle this problem.
I think, you know, this is one of the most important point you highlighted. And we also agree with you that whatever projects, what are the initiatives till now is happening across the country, these kind of things are partially taken care, you know, inclusion of each and every citizens, or you know, whether it is in a particular city or in a town or in a country. My suggestion would be is that, you know, wherever any projects are coming up or being conceptualized, I think that stage itself, you know, this thing should be highlighted. And within this team, within this room, I think, you know, GT is there and all other friends are there. I think this is one of the point which, you know, we should highlight to the authority, to MOUD as well. Especially I think there can be a separate discussion taking more details from you and your team, you know, rightly, and what are the real relevant points to be highlighted. I think it's a very, very relevant point. You are rightly said is that most of the cities which are kind of developed countries we have seen, and their policies are actually well defined from this all this respect, you know, whether it's a buildings, commercial buildings or commercial office or any place, any bus stop, anywhere, you know, accessibility is something is being taken care for everybody. It is a very, very, very valid and relevant point.
And unfortunately, people don't understand that everyone has the possibility of being disabled at one point of life, whether it is being acquiring age or oldest or senior citizens. It is going to impact all of us sitting in this room. So, I mean, I still fail to understand that we're not able to communicate to the system integrators and the stakeholders that you need to incorporate this into design.
Asif, you as a PwC person, Ravi and Padma from GT, are running the almost 50 to 60% of the cities right now. You take a pledge. You take a pledge, then all the tenders, accessibility would be considered from technology side. But I can assure from my company, and I can take a liberty from all my friends, we will honor that part of yours and we'll give you the right technology accessible in the smart cities. Please address also in your organization to ensure that they are pushing this button more and more. We will also do that.
Yes, sir, we are very determined, but the system integrator is not buying our arguments. Unfortunately, even the client was in our favor. Even the client was in our favor, but unfortunately, system integrator is probably giving a different story. I'm confident we will eventually, good sense will prevail. But again, I'm so glad I'm attending this, and I'm hoping and requesting all the system integrators to please think of all this, because this is a win-win situation for you also. And if you create this, I'm sure you're going to have an opportunity to replicate the solutions elsewhere also.
If I could just...
yeah, sure, absolutely.
So I think digital inclusion has another dimension which I just want to kind of highlight, is one of how it impacts privacy, right? Because a lot of theory around privacy is based on the concept of consent. But then if the person who is giving the consent isn't clearly, you know, sure of what he is giving consent to or doesn't know the options, then that becomes kind of suspect, right? So if you look at the entire system of IoT, IoT-enabled networks and smart cities which come out of it, the whole concept of, you know, privacy and security are extremely important. And the privacy aspect has a, you know, huge overlap area with digital inclusion. And I think if I use an analogy, in the last 60, 70 years, with the extension of the market economy into every aspect of human existence, right? Today, you can skip a temple queue by buying a more expensive ticket in many temples. So suddenly, you create a society where if you don't have access to money or you don't have enough money, every aspect of your life is inferior,
which wasn't what it was 30 years ago. You know, for people old enough, you know, in their childhood, you would have experienced it, a very different society. I think we risk what has happened on the economic scale to happen on the, in these smart cities from a technology aspect, where you completely disadvantage, you know, segments of society who are old, unable to learn new things, or do not have access to education, all of those kind of things and so on. So this is a very, very key aspect. It has to come in through policy intervention. It has to come in through, people like us, you know, constantly pushing the envelope to make sure that this is part of the kind of society and the kind of smart cities that we would all like to live in.
Yeah, so, I wouldn't talk about digital part of it, but I'm sure, because, and I totally agree with Asif that inclusion for everybody, as far as the scheme itself is concerned, is very important aspect, but is it being covered universally? Absolutely no. But in this, hey, I always see some specks of light. There is one city in the Northeast where they are trying to replace the entire footpath, chain in the city to be accessible by different labeled people. So these are the small specks of light that we keep seeing. That idea came from me, but I'm sure, there's somebody intelligent enough who thought that idea and getting it implemented. So, some such things are already happening, but I take your point that it has to be much more widely, promulgated and accepted all across.
Yeah. I think a very interesting debate and discussion. So we touched upon issues which are technological, structural, and institutional. Very often, one of the issue which gets neglected is the issue of citizens' voice, right? So I'm sure there are a few things which are done to involve the citizen in designing and doing what needs to be done for a smart city. Do you think it's enough? What more can be done to have a higher representation of civil society's voice in designing smarter cities?
Definitely, it's not enough. So I think we as consultants are facing this on a day-to-day basis. Although the initial part was done with citizen involvement and, the SCP itself was framed based on their consensus only, I think the time to revisit each of them when projects get reprioritized by the corporation doesn't just necessarily go back to the citizens for a reiteration or to get a stamp from them for the second time. Similarly, the implementation modalities which gets discussed and debated and finally agreed upon doesn't get communicated to the citizens. So definitely point taken. So we need to have a much more robust communication system and a citizen engagement system to make things happen. Otherwise, we will not even be able to achieve 10-20% of what we actually want to achieve in the smart city. That's the thing.
I think I'm just bringing the analogy from the way that we run our own commercial entity, right? So there's a board for us whom we report to. And board governs our mechanism of, serving the stakeholders and shareholders. I think if SPV's board is governed by the civil society, this could be a one way of bringing the voice mechanism and the return of investment that I was talking about earlier. Could be one suggestion. The second suggestion is that I'm just bringing the same experience of my own company. I've been always asked every quarter, Sanjeev, what are you doing? Show me your feedback, show me your progress, your numbers, da-da-da-da-da. In the civil society mechanism, we establish for running the, some sort of a monitoring type of stuff in terms of the progress from the citizen's perspective, not from the purely technology implementation side. At the end of the day, what benefit the society is getting? How much efficient it is? If that's the way we monitor every quarter to quarter and the board, I think maybe a small, maybe good one or big one, I'm not sure, but I just thought that he put up this recommendation.
So we did this. Bangalore already has a report card system. So every year when the annual budget gets announced by the BBMP, this report card is one big thing. And, for the next 10 days in the newspapers, it's all about the report card. But again, we do the benchmarking and we do have the indices and the parameters. But what do you do after that? Like it just 10 years and it fizzles out. That's it. So till the next year, nobody is bothered about the return. So I think as citizens, it's also on to us to, properly want to revisit the report card and probably replicate that system in many of the other UL base just as a benchmarking exercise. So I think, yeah, we had a very good, yeah, please.
Ma'am has one question up behind.
It must be the smallest city under the program. It's a city called Namchi in Sikkim. So they try to, yeah, absolutely, yeah, please, we are known.
Namchi. Last 10 years I've been searching for good footpaths.
Interestingly, actually, in fact, we are trying to replace the entire footpath system and convert into, it's not exactly digitally smart, but it's smart for as far as accessibility is concerned by different disabled people. So there are different kind of tiles which are available for different aspects.
Tactiles,
something like that. So they are so they're going to replace the entire thing in Namchi.
There's a question there she was asking.
I wanted to just add a small point about citizen engagement. I live in Faridabad. And the Faridabad Badkal Lake under the Smart City program was up for design renovation. And there was a competition that was opened up in schools for RWAs, the Resident Welfare Associations, to contribute to the new plan. Did you want a walkway? Did you want trees here? So there were a set of questions they asked. They gave the engineering drawing as was planned or given by the architects. And then it was opened up and said, if you didn't like this design, we would like your school or your RWA to run a competition and get us your recommended suggestions to top it or modify it or suggest an absolutely new design. I think that was a very fantastic exercise. It was a very engaging exercise where they were actually involved in us, not in giving a feedback on something probably for which they don't comprehend that as a professional, but in terms of how they perceive some spaces and public spaces getting lesser and lesser in urbanized areas, this becomes even more critical. Also, there's another group called Jagori, which actually asserts by walking in large numbers public spaces. So they walk at night at 9 o'clock in a garden, and they announce that they're going to walk. That makes the local area police to make sure that it is safe for them to walk. Now, this is getting a city to change its perspective. We want not only a smart city, we also want a safe city. So I think there are some elements of project management consulting that should take into account public spaces and access to public spaces. Access not only from the ability perspective, but also from a gender perspective. It's very important. And the last point is that a lot of places are going to get lost. And I discussed it with Mr. Reddy. There are heritage houses, heritage buildings. And probably they have not been kept well. And this is an opportunity when we are thinking of these 100 smart cities. It should become an integral part of the design, that while you're renovating the roads and the traffic management system and the pathways, you also ought to keep that culture alive by restoring, maintaining the cultural buildings. That is very much part of this. So just a few thoughts to add to the conversations. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks, very useful. Any questions?
Yeah, the two things that the smart cities, SPVs and the ministry has to look into that. I feel that the convergence is one of the important aspects. We have built in so much of IT systems, earlier to the smart cities and before the SPVs are formed. And the smart cities really need to focus on the converging those projects and as an integral part of the smart city solutions. Is one aspect. The other aspect coming to the monitoring and evaluation of the entire project. So there is a need for the government and non-government coordination. And there was in Andhra Pradesh, there was a committee called GO-NGO Coordination Committee. So such systems that needs to be part of the integral part of the entire monitoring system of the smart city mission.
Yeah, thank you. So I think we had a very exciting session with a lot of thought process coming out, and whatever we have agreed here, I think GT would summarize it and probably, you know, help the ministry also to, you know, roll out those things. So thank you one and all for joining in this great thing. And anything else? Yeah. So we just like to honor them.